wake up everybody, no more sleeping in bed, no more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty.
Good morning, or afternoon, or whatever time you're watching the show. My name is O.W. Sweeney, and I'm here with my co-host and my brother and a great friend, an old friend, because we both are up in age, and we've been friends a long time. Richard Courts, how you doing today, brother?
I'm doing quite well.
All right.
Brother O.W. Sweeney.
All right, yeah, so let's go ahead and get in North Carolina, Triad Jobs with justice. And let's say put that with justice in here.
Yeah. Jobs
with justice. And you can reach us at 336-272-2758. Okay,
now that we
got that out of the way, we're gonna talk about a topic of unionism and something we don't like, that those business unions that we've been calling for quite a while have done. I know back in when Reagan was president and the air traffic controllers went on strike, the labor movement abandoned them. And I say abandoned them.
That was under the leadership of Lane Kirkland.
Yes.
When he was the head of the AFL-CIO.
Did you say Lane or Lane?
I used to always say Lane Kirkland, because in relation to the corporations and the big banks, he was about as lame as you can get.
Yeah.
And he was lame when it came, and he betrayed, and he in particular, and then the AFL-CIO Council in general, betrayed the PATO workers and thereby betrayed all the workers in this country.
And one thing that happened in that period, unionism fall off.
Absolutely.
And those people supposed to be up there working, representing us, seem more like they represent the boss.
Yeah, big business.
The capitalists.
Right.
As a matter of fact, my personal opinion, I think most of them think they're in that corporate world because they're in that leadership role rather than working the workers. Now, we done talked a lot of time. I think a lot of them, they make too much money. They don't relate to the workers anymore. They relate to corporate America, and that's where they stand. And it's a crying shame that those Democrats who are going around now talking about they're going to do things for the people.
And for union, pro-union.
Well,
that's what they say.
They'll be better off being an enemy the way I see it, or they are an enemy. Mm-hmm. Because passing that bill without giving them workers or nothing what they want was no
You're
more.
You're talking about the railroad workers.
Yeah, the railroad workers was no more than representing the money part.
Right.
They get those big campaign contributions, as they call it, bribes, as I call them,
right.
And they do what those people want to be done. They don't do nothing for the workers. I know I can't think of what the union guy said, but we remember this when it's time to come to vote again. And I think I know I for one, I know I'm going to remember it.
Good. Yeah, I think today, as it happened, a man that I consider a friend, who's a white conservative, middle class guy, but I'm about as close to him as I am to anybody who fits that description. He raised with me, he said, what did you think about the railroad workers and President Biden? And he wasn't trying to be smart, you know, that's one of the things I like about him. He was genuinely
concerned.
He was curious.
Yeah.
As a white conservative, he was in favor of forcing the workers to stay on the job and suppressing the strike. I mean, he didn't put it in those words. But he couldn't understand why Biden, he took Biden at his word, even though he supported the opposites to a large extent, or the alternative, so-called Republican alternative, without being an open white supremacist. In it, without being totally eaten up with white supremacy and fascism.
I don't think all Republicans are racist, and I don't think all Democrats are not racist. They got some racism in both parties.
Mm-hmm. A lot of it. in both. That's what I'm just saying. We got some. And I'm not saying that he's free of white supremacy, but he doesn't have a lot of it compared to the amount that's right. out there, even among black people, such as the person who just failed to represent Trump in Georgia, Herschel Walker. Getting back to what he raised with me, he takes Biden's word that Biden is pro-union, pro-labor. And I said, I've never considered him to be pro-labor. I said, he's a corporate representative, a corporate flunky. And just as when he was the vice president, the president he was with, Barack Obama, was also a corporate flunky, and I reminded him that when Obama was went in as president, Wall Street was a little bit concerned because they also buy a little bit of their own propaganda, and they were worried that Obama was going to take all kinds of steps to restrict the kind of robbery, you know, big business robbery of the rest of us that went on in that economic crisis, and they were relieved when they met with Obama for the first time, which was very soon after
he found out that he was
not going to do anything to that, and they were so relieved, and that they were able to keep on with their fleecing of us, and I reminded him of that today, that was the record with Obama. So why should we expect
him
different from Biden?
Right.
But I found it interesting, O.W., that he, this white conservative, who has some integrity, was taking Biden at his word. So you can imagine the people that Biden is making the promises to, and voted for him, their desire to take him at his word. But the fact that Biden went wholeheartedly and led the Congress, the Democrats, which they control both houses at this moment, and led both houses in suppressing the needs of the majority, and the expressed will of the majority of the workers. Because one thing that was a little bit unclear to me, and an old friend of mine cleared it up for me, was that there were 12 different rail unions involved in this whole big negotiation, and only four of those labor unions did the workers vote to not accept and to reject and go on strike that proposal that ended up coming from.
And I still hope they go out. Hope they go out.
But at any rate, but those four unions that rejected it, the majority of the workers of those 12 unions were in those four unions. So it was the majority of the workers who expressed a rejection
of
that agreement.
That's right.
And that's where you and I stand with the majority of the workers when
they
speak. And so the question is, well, why did Biden do it? And the answer is the same answer that you give for the Democrats and the Republicans.
The campaign contribution.
The campaign contribution.
Which I call a bribe.
Right, yeah. And that's who Biden's been all his whole career. Is that representative of Wall Street?
I would like to quote a phrase that I like to use. You said the United States, not to say it, America got the best politician that money can buy. And this absolutely proves it. Because if Biden stood up for anything for the workers, he would have gave them some sick days in there. I mean, he sent the bill down there to the House and the Senate, and it's supposed to be two bills, and they said the only one they could pass was the one that had no sick time in there.
Right.
That's the only one they shouldn't have put, should sit down there. If they were going to send a bill down there to force those workers back to work because they're scared of what would happen to the economy, they should have gave them some sick time. And like I said, I still hope they go out on strike. I mean, they're so much worried about the economy of the American people, but they're not worried about the workers of America, the citizens of America.
the workers of the United States.
And then they got nerve enough to get mad when them Americans come from Central America up here. So I mean, they're crazy.
But I think the fact is that the Biden administration represents monopoly capitalism and imperialism, just like the previous administrations, with the slight exception of Trump, who represented the Trump dynasty,
right,
and wasn't necessarily concerned to represent all the rest of it.
Even though he threw him some crumbs.
I believe the reason Trump was able to stay in for 4 years was because he managed to deliver the tax boondoggle for the super rich on Wall Street, and that's why they allowed him to remain in there, no matter what crimes he committed. But getting back to this rail strike, the aborted rail strike, the suppressed rail strike.
The enslavement of working people.
Exactly, and that's where I'm going with this, O.W. The sticking issue, because they did get a money package, and they had already negotiated that money package.
And they turned it down.
But that's right, and they used their rights as working people to express the fact that that was not sufficient, that they were being so squeezed on the job, they were being compelled to stay at work under all kinds of conditions because they had no sick leave, no rights to time off, and people were shocked. Even some of the liberal democratic apologists were shocked that these railroad workers had no sick days.
Yeah.
And yet, the railroad unions, as you and I know, as old union people, in more ways than one, that in the history of the United States, the railroad unions were one of the earliest well-organized union forces in the country.
Yes.
So the idea that in 2022, they were struggling to get some sick days, and that was the sticking point, and the fact is that the lack of sick days means that you lack any kind of say-so in your on-the-job situation. Because if they give them even like 5 sick days or 7 sick days or whatever a year, which is so little compared to what we would get in the post office and even many other workers in many other jobs.
They couldn't even give them 1 day a month.
Right, exactly. And they couldn't even give them 1 day a year, and because it represented a level of power for the union workers in relation to the company.
You and I
worked in the post office when there were an awful lot of casual employees in the post office that had to wait, or management at least would coerce them to wait by their phone for a call, and they were always on call.
That's right.
And no rights, basically.
Yeah.
And so we know the importance of union workers. One of the most significant things about being in a union is that you as a worker have some say-so.
Consolidating power.
Exactly. And so it was clear, not only to you and me, but to anyone that watched this situation, that those big railroad capitalists, they didn't give up 1 sick day to get this point across. In other words, you and I would have had a more difficult time exposing the Biden administration and the Democrats, as well as the Republicans that went with this. In fact, a few right-wing Republicans who have been horrible on the small d democracy, have been horrible on the rights of the Afro-American people, have been horrible on labor rights. They couldn't help themselves. They came out against Biden's settlement, saying that they didn't show any respect for the workers' voices.
That's right.
These are people like Josh Hawley, one of the worst representatives, senators up in D.C. And so that is, I think, the biggest explanation for what happened. That the railroad companies, they want to maintain their power over the workers to such a degree that they didn't even offer this extra little whatever you want to call it, token, really, of a couple of sick days to the workers, because even that token would have been a base of power for the unions involved.
And the failure of the AFL-CIO to back them up just goes so far to give unionism a bad name. It cost us before, and I think it's going to cost us again. But I think we need to send a message at the ballot box. Those politicians need to be voted out. And this new leadership they got coming in from the House, who's going around talking about they're for the people, they need to be voted out themselves. Yeah. I mean, we need strong leadership. We need people to stand up to those corporations. If we don't show our consolidated strength against that oppressive force, we will never get nowhere. Right. We will always be sheep.
And part of that is that I guess we got some wolves in sheep's clothing in terms of our many of our national
leaders.
So-called leaders.
So-called.
Or maybe
that's a good way to put it. Yeah. So-called leaders.
Right. Because as you said, nothing came from the AFL-CIO top leadership to help pressure either the Biden administration, but they supposedly have this their Democratic Party connection, or even the railroad capital. No, these so-called labor leaders put no pressure on the railroad capitalists to get concessions on sick days.
But they did, but also they did not pressure Biden. All they had to say to Biden is, you give him something. That's why I like the European style. They call it nationwide strike.
Right.
Everybody shut it down.
Right.
But these leaders over here, so-called leaders over here, seem like they got their head up their butt and kissing our way rather than standing up for the workers.
Right.
And we have to get the message to them too that they have to go.
Right. Yeah, and I think that's you're right. It's an exposure both of the Democratic Party and the Biden administration in particular. And it's about as strong a promise where Biden has been saying over and over again that he's the most pro-union president the country has ever had. And him saying that he guaranteed basically to the Afro-American people, after admitting that it was the Afro-American people that had been there for him, he said that this is around the question of voting rights. We know that he failed on voting rights.
Yes.
At the same time, but he didn't fail on supporting the railroad and big Wall Street capital against the railroad workers.
That's right. So, against the working force.
And the labor movement, the so-called labor leaders at the top of the AFL-CIO, who were silent in relation to this whole situation. And one thing about it, I want to get your thoughts on this. My own feeling is part of the bankruptcy of not only the Democrats, but especially the labor leadership, is there was no real talk about nationalizing the railroad industry. In other words, if Biden was going to say, well, these railroad capitalists aren't going to give any more, and meanwhile, the workers on the railroad are really desperate to get some time off and get more, because they've lost about 35 or 40% of their workforce over the last few years. It's not an accident that they're being pressed to the breaking point at this point. There's that kind of shortage of workers on the railroad. For the rest of us, the railroad job is a good job. We ought to make sure there are a lot more of them. A lot more of those jobs, and make it a better life for the railroad workers and their families that are there already. So the labor movement is, I think you're right. I think the focus in some ways needs to even be more on the labor movement, especially its misleadership that failed to even raise up the question. If these railroad capitalists are not in a position to give one sick day, then they need to be replaced. Let's nationalize the railroads. So So that, just like the post office is a public institution.
And they want to split that up.
They want to privatize.
Privatize.
Absolutely.
All right. And people really can't see what's going on there, and they're not really looking. And once the postal service is gone, they're going to say, well, we need it back. It's too late then. You got to speak up now.
Yeah. It was surprising this year that Biden, the one thing I think Biden did that was good in this year was he signed the Postal Service Reform Act, which gives some level of stability, at least for the time being, to against the privatizers of the Postal Service. And even DeJoy, who's a much maligned, he's earned it, Postmaster General, but he's also a Republican fat cat donor.
Right.
He helped to get Biden and the Postal Service Reform Act passed. And that was a good thing.
Yes. So,
but we need that kind of relief.
But that sounds like a sheep and wolf problem to me.
Yeah. Well, I think we better keep a good eye on it.
Yes.
That's for sure.
Oh, yes, because he's done some of the things that tear the Postal Service down.
Absolutely. Before he found out. And his buddy Trump that appointed him found out that the Postal Service is one public service that the people of the country, Republicans, Democrats, Independents, you name it, support. And once he found that out, then he was backing up and doing some right things.
But he
helped the 2020 election to get.
He didn't back up far enough because he didn't resign.
True. That's true.
So,
but it is an interesting thing. Politics makes strange bets, all of those things.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
But it don't make strange bedfellows for the workers.
Right.
Only thing it does is makes them into slaves for this here, for the capitalists of this country.
Right.
And we got to realize if we want our independence, we're gonna have to stand up and fight for it. We're gonna have to go to war. Like I say, as far as I'm concerned, I hope they still go out on the night. I hope they shut the country down. Let the people realize that you can pass a law to make me work, which I thought making a person work was slavery.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, we had full employment under slavery, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, how you gonna make somebody work who don't want to work?
Right.
There's plenty of people out here, some of them out here begging out of necessity, but some of them out just doing it because they don't want to work. But now you got some people who got a job and they want something to keep their family safe and keep their job going good. Then you're going to force them to work.
Keep their family's health.
That's right.
As well. Yeah. These are some of the essential workers that people among the rich pay lip service to, but they don't pay them in terms of benefits, rights,
that's right.
And wages.
That's right.
Like they should. And so people have to do that. They're going to have to organize for themselves.
We're supposed to be organized, but it seems that we split among ourselves. We want to call ourselves middle class workers, upper middle class workers, when the whole story is we all are workers, mm-hmm. regardless of that salary total that you got.
Right.
I understand you get a job, you have to do what the boss man says. But you still don't understand that you're just a worker. And workers must stick together, regardless of what level they are.
Because being just a worker is acting just the fact that you're the ones who make the world go round.
And as workers, we must let the politician know you work for us and we need to fire you. And that's in the ballot box. Because I don't know what's going to happen to 2024 election, but this passing this bill to force those people to go back to work and the railroad workers back to work is going to take a toll on the Democrats come 2024.
Yeah. And I agree with you, and it's also a step back into some form of real open slavery.
Oh yes,
that's what it amounts to, and among one of the most organized sections of the U.S.
Right.
workers.
That's right.
So I'm not sure where we are in this on this show right now, but we're getting close to the end.
Yes.
So I think one of the main lessons is, if we can approach progressive, is that for the big capitalists, owners of a railroad.
Right. The person that you call them.
Yeah, that they couldn't, or they were unwilling to even get up off of a few cities because they're afraid that once the railroad workers have some power in their own situation, they'll realize...
They still have that power.
They have the power.
All they got to do is not go to work.
But that takes much more organization when you don't have it in your contract. Now, what happened in the post office
in
1970, and that's how we ended up having a better unionized, much better union.
That's right, because we showed our power.
Right.
That's why I say I still hope those rail workers go out.
Yeah.
I don't care if don't people 15 or 20 in the country. Call and see.
Well, I don't agree with you, because if it's only 15 or 20 in the country, and they can be...
I'm talking about in each city, but not just...
Yeah. I think it's a matter, that's a matter of time.
Yeah, but what I'm saying, if those 15 or 20 are calling and don't go to work, that'll put a crippling spot within this system, because the system will not run as it should.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think it's time for us to get a North Carolina triad job with justice, another plug, where you can reach us at 336-272-2758.
And I think that the railroad workers will end up striking even much more strongly than they would have this time, once they go through more of this bitter experience, and the experience under the Democratic Party and Biden.
Yes.
In our unity.
What does the government care? They're doing a dirty deed. Old man sleeping on the cold street. They took his dream, he's gone to sea.